Hi, I'm Kirk Jowers, and I'm pleased to host a new series from doTERRA about COVID-19. As always, my expert to guide us on this is Dr. Russell Osgathorpe.
Hi, Kirk.
Thank you for being with us.
Good to be with you.
This is the second of our foundational episodes on social distancing and coping. And I want to get practical right off the bat today. Everyone keeps seeing these lists, and people still can't really list them, but I think this will get us there. So I'm going to ask you some questions in rapid fire for you to answer, and we'll just kind of walk through them.
Okay.
All right. These are practical questions for people who do not have the virus, or at least are asymptomatic, have no symptoms of the virus.
Okay.
Should people go to work?
That's a really easy one right off the bat.
Yeah.
It totally depends on where you live, what the recommendations are of your local government, your public health department, and healthcare professionals, is the short answer. But underneath your question is it's a question about risk. But
right.
I know that my answer sounds a little bit like I'm dodging the question, but it really does matter on where you live and what viral transmission is like where you live. So in countries where viral transmission is very high, the answer to the question is no, you shouldn't go to work. In countries where viral transmission of COVID-19 is very, very low, the question is yes, you should probably go to work, and we should watch very carefully for when the virus is increasing rapidly. And once it reaches a threshold, then epidemiologists and folks at the public health department, along with government officials, will make recommendations about don't go to work or stuff like that. Does that help?
That does help. Because, of course, I knew it was an impossible question, because, of course, a lot of people have to go to work because we still have to eat. We still...
Yeah. Life has to go on.
We still need toilet paper, apparently, because people are fighting for it all over the world. But should people take subways, buses, airplanes, trains?
Okay. So really easy again.
Yeah.
But right now I would say if you can avoid that, I would. Social distancing is the way I answer this question. It's very hard to socially distance on a subway. It's very difficult to do it on an airplane. If you can avoid travel, or if there's another way for you to get where you are going, this would be the time to do that. And you should avoid methods of transportation and travel that require you to be in very close contact with large numbers of people. And I think personally that that makes sense worldwide. This now is in most countries. And for the countries that
123 countries, according to the World Health Organization.
Right. And in many of the countries where we don't have evidence of COVID, they're probably not testing.
Right.
And so I would say that if you can limit travel, you should.
Restaurants, grocery stores?
Again, it comes down to risk. So what I would say to grocery stores and restaurants, they're two different things, so I'll tackle both. Yeah, we need to go to the grocery store, we need to get food, and we need to provide for our families. So yes, you can go to the grocery store, just do so in a manner that allows social distancing to be your phrase of the day.
And danger zones would be the handles of the
carts
and things like that, right?
If you can go to the grocery store and you're going to use a cart that's been used by others before, wipe it down,
right?
Make sure that it's clean. Try and use a sanitizer of some sort before you use a cart that's been used by others.
Frequent hand sanitizers.
This is just real common sense stuff,
yeah.
Right? So I don't want to get people to panic around these sorts of questions that you're asking, because people need to live. But going to the grocery store is different than getting on a plane with 300 people.
Right.
Going to the grocery store is not the same as getting on a crowded subway. I think the most important phrase is social distancing. You want to remember that. And if you can manage social distancing, at whatever question you're asking, should I do that? Should I do this? Social distancing is the way that you answer the question. If you can do it, then the answer is likely, yeah, I think that's probably pretty safe or very low risk. If you can't maintain social distance from somebody, then it becomes something you should try and avoid.
Local gym, we're told, in addition to all the
like
preventative
exercise,
things, we're supposed to exercise, eat right. you know, supplements, do all the things to get our immunity boosted. But now if we, maybe we can get our social distancing at a gym, but we still don't know who touched the barbell and the equipment before we did.
It's really important to do things that decrease stress and improve your health while going through a pandemic. Exercise is one of those things that's been shown to decrease stress and improve health.
Right.
So as I answer this question, please don't think that I'm saying don't exercise.
Okay.
What I want people to think about, though, is that if you can exercise more safely, do so.
Right.
Go for a walk, go for a run. Don't use the treadmill if you can avoid it, if it's been used by 100 people. Or make sure that if you are using a treadmill, if weather requires that you exercise inside or at a gym, wipe things down, use hand sanitizers. You can mitigate risk. You can mitigate risk by wiping things down and cleaning things carefully. But in general, do things that allow you to keep social distance.
Switching for just a moment so that people understand the magnitude of this, with your almost two decades of experience in infectious diseases, you've seen a lot. How infectious is this virus compared to the others you've experienced?
Data is changing rapidly on what we know about the infectivity of the virus. There's a lot of epidemiologic research behind how we define a certain virus's infectivity, and that data is not yet completed for COVID-19. Okay. So we can't answer that question definitively. But so far, the preliminary information out of China would indicate that a person who is infected does spread the virus to more than one person. But how many people, we're going to wait and see until we've got enough data to answer that question definitively.
Speaking of more and more people being worried about having the virus, and of course actually having it, reports of overloading hospitals, clinics, looking for tests. Tell us the main three symptoms again so that we hear them. What should we be advising people as far as getting these tests or trying to get these tests?
Okay. So the symptoms of COVID-19, again, are fever, cough, and shortness of breath. Those are the triad that we spoke about in our last episode. They're very similar.
Shortness of breath. Let me just make sure what that means. The other two seem pretty easy, pretty obvious.
It means that you just feel like you have to breathe more frequently to catch your breath, that you're trying to catch your breath all the time. It doesn't necessarily mean that you have to work really hard to get your breath, that you have to strain to get breath in. Short of breath just means that you're breathing, but you can't catch your breath. You just feel like you're constantly trying to get more air.
If you've got two out of the three, are you getting nervous, or do you really need all three at this point?
The triad is not seen in every patient.
Okay.
Okay. So if you have any of those symptoms and live in an area, live in a part of the world where coronavirus transmission is extremely high, if you had any one of those symptoms, you should seek medical attention and potentially be tested. Your medical professional will help you decide if you should be tested or not in your local environment, because testing is different in every country right now.
If you think you have the disease, or maybe even know you have the disease, if your country has enough tests to confirm that for you, what should you do?
So if you think you have the disease and can't get tested, or if you've been tested positive for COVID-19, you should quarantine yourself. And that means that you should stay at home, not go out, and not expose other people to the disease. That will slow the transmission of the disease. Because once you know you have the disease, or once you think you have the disease, you should really take yourself out of circulation. Stay at home until you get better. Seek medical attention if you get worse. If you go from mild shortness of breath to, I just am struggling to breathe. Yes. I am really, really working hard to breathe. I'm having to use all of my muscles to get breath. You need to be seen. But if you can stay home and get better from what for most people in the Chinese outbreak and in the Korean outbreak seem to have mild disease, not requiring hospitalization, then you can stay at home, take yourself out of circulation, and not expose others to the virus.
And what about the next step? What if it's my wife who has it, but I'm with her all the time? Do I need to get away from her, or do I now have some responsibility towards the rest of the community as well because I am now a higher risk person?
Yep, it's a great question. So what we do for close social contacts is we want to limit their isolation to the rest of the community as well. But caregivers at home of somebody who has COVID-19 need to be very mindful of hand washing and avoiding secretions whenever possible.
Okay.
If you have a home where you can isolate in a different part of the home or at a different room, you should do that. And whenever possible, you should limit and try and cover coughs with elbows so that you don't infect others in your family, if at all possible. There is some evidence that family transmission is quite efficient at coming out of the Chinese outbreak. So sometimes, like many viral diseases, I'm sure in your family, you've seen viral diseases go through multiple members of the family over a several week period of time.
Right.
And that can happen, it looks like, with COVID as well. So anybody who's caring for somebody with COVID or thinks that they have COVID should really use common sense measures of keeping social distance when you can, covering cough if you're the one who's sick, washing your hands frequently. Those are going to be the best ways of preventing transmission within family members. And then lastly, if you can, isolate the individual, even within your own home, as much as possible from other members of the family.
The last topic I wanted to address, because we're hoping these episodes are ones that people will have as a resource to go back to. Maybe they don't care too much about it now because everyone's healthy, mm-hmm. but if something happens. But let's talk about the mental health and coping during a pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
Both for just everyone at large, what can people do to support themselves?
Yep, it's very important, actually.
But I guess let's start here. What type of reaction should we expect during an infectious disease outbreak?
Anxiety. So what is so striking about any pandemic is the amount of news coverage and anxiety that these situations bring. Some of that anxiety is very warranted, and some of it is over-exaggerated. But regardless of how the story unfolds with whichever disease we're talking about, anxiety is a real problem during a pandemic. I believe personally that it's a real problem right now in many parts of the world for COVID-19.
And how should parents be supporting their children and their anxieties that they may be feeling?
I think it's really important just to recognize it and talk about it with one another and be patient with one another.
Yeah.
People are different and they respond to stressful situations differently, even within your own family. Personalities do differently.
It's definitely true. We've been trying for a couple. We're trying to say this is actually something you need to pay attention to. We don't want you going to a 200 person dance now. Mm-hmm. And they laugh because
no big deal.
It's no big deal. And then others are quite nervous about the whole thing.
Or maybe overly nervous.
Overly nervous.
So
we
have both ends of the spectrum.
Yeah.
So I think we just need to be cognizant and allow one another room to experience the difficult questions and anxieties that COVID-19 are bringing. Or when people feel this anxiety, their voice levels raise, people start to yell, things that didn't bother them before start to bother them now, and
right.
Family members get stressed at one another, people get stressed that are not family members at other people in the workplace and in lots of different locations. Most important thing we can do when we need to take a break from pandemic is to unplug. I believe the most effective measure that you can employ to decrease your feelings of stress and anxiety are to just put your phone down,
yeah.
turn off the computer, and engage with your family doing something that you love to do. Go for a walk outside, see the sunshine, see the sky. Don't look at a screen.
Right.
For an hour or two. If you were to do that, you'll see that things will feel differently afterward.
Yeah.
We all have our breaking point. And when you are approaching it, do things that will lower your breaking point. These kinds of things will dramatically improve in just a relatively short
right.
period of time how you feel at that moment.
Thank you so much for joining us today. And remember, every day, as long as it's warranted, we will have a new episode that will hopefully concisely let you know the events of the day and how you can best cope with COVID-19.
take care of each other, take care of as many people as you can, be kind.